Hey guys, I'm Felice. I'm here on the North Shore of Kauai at Common Ground. I've been interning here for the last 3 months, learning about regenerative agriculture and agroforestry. So I'm going to be showing you today a little bit about the agroforest they have here. It's only about 2 years old, a little bit less than that. And I'm here with the farmer, John Parziale. He's going to be discussing some of the core principles of regenerative agriculture, how he's implemented them here, and then we're going to be talking about the design of the agroforest. And then after that, we're going to be headed over to his homestead to see what the same agroforestry design looks like after 20 years. And you'll be able to see it's drastically different. So I'm excited to show you guys what we have here today.
So the best way to describe regenerative agriculture is the concept of farm as ecosystem. So some of the principles that define regenerative agriculture include just basic methods or principles that care for the soil. So the soil is seen as a living macroorganism, a living matrix, which is the basis for all the yields and abundance in the system. So of those principles that deal with soil care, we have number one would be a minimal disturbance of the soil, so low-till or no-till scenarios. We have covering the soil with either living plants or mulch, no bare soil cultivation, and then we have keeping a living root system throughout the year. So that's second nature to us in the tropics, especially in perennial systems like agroforestry. In addition to that, some of the other principles could include biodiversity, or just a diversity of specimens within any agricultural system. Biodiversity breeds resilience into the system, and it also, again, models an ecosystem which are naturally biodiverse. In addition to those principles, finally, we can include the integration of animals into the growing system or the ecosystem. So here we have a multi-species grazing model where between our agroforestry rows we're grazing dairy cattle followed by chicken tractors and grazing pasture-raised chickens. These boost the fertility of the soil and help cycle the nutrients and products and energies within the system. So one of the things we think about in systems like this are closed-loop models. Closed-loop models of production, fertility, and energy. So what that looks like here, for example, would be like our chicken tractors that roll through these pasture strips. They are feeding on the pasture. They are fertilizing the ground, which all of these trees and neighboring specimens can make use of that fertility. And then, especially when they're parked by a tree, for example, like a ulu tree like this, these chickens were raised exclusively off the farm for the first 6 months of their life. So they were eating fermented breadfruit as a carbohydrate source, fly larvae, and also pasture. So it's really easy to see the system feeding the chickens. And then as the chickens are rolling through, it's really easy at that point to see that the chickens, by leaving their fertility, are feeding things like the trees as well. For example, when the cows come through, it's a very similar arrangement. They're leaving their fertility behind as they're grazing the pasture, cycling nutrients, and they also, in addition to eating the pasture, the cows also get a high protein forage from the nitrogen-fixing trees in the system, such as pigeon pea, gloricidia, and Inga specimens. So again, there's an interconnectedness between the animals in the system and the plant and trees. And those systems are what build resilience into a system like that. So another way that we cycle nutrients is with the use of leguminous trees, such as Gluricidia, which is right above my head. The Gluricidia is a great example. It's a massive producer of fertility for our system. So it makes its fertility out of the thin air. It's what all nitrogen fixers do, like peas and beans. And in the tropics, we have a wide variety of nitrogen-fixing trees. So they pull nitrogen from the air. They store it at their root system with an association with a bacteria in the root zone. And so the growth is super prolific. The Gluricidia, for example, is a high-protein cattle forage for us. It provides a massive amount of biomass, which we mulch our tree rows with. Some of the larger trunks we run through our chipper to make wood chips. We have an example of that here. So a lot of our soil structure here is enriched by this is all Gluricidia wood chip. And just within a few inches of the soil, we get to nice moist mulch. Right above our head is another nitrogen fixer. This is Inga, or ice cream bean, which is really, especially in the global south, it is revolutionizing agricultural systems on contour rows. So basically, this tree is being used to prevent the rainforest from being slashed and burned for annual production. One of the most prolific plants in our agroforestry system is the pigeon pea, which is continually, especially this time of year, is continually snapped and pruned by hand. You don't need any kind of clippers or tools, and it is mulched, and again, it cycles nutrients through the system. So in this type of agroforestry system, there's a definite architecture of especially the long-term specimens, and then there's a successional model that mimics the way that nature produces forests, and we try to mimic that system as the years go by. So we have a long-term emergent specimen here, which is a betel nut palm. We have some medium-term plants in here, 2 to 3 year crops like sugarcane. This is Ie, one of the noble Hawaiian canes. Of course, we have pineapples in the understory, a few more noble cane varieties. We have, this is a coffee whose genetics come from the Nepali coast in a naturalized setting. Pigeon pea as a nurse plant. We have a papaya, which is a short-term emergent layer. It'll be gone probably in about a year from now. And this is a ulu tree. So the ulu tree is a long-term large specimen that its canopy will extend all the way out toward the first palm that we mention, the betel nut palm, and that palm will actually be above the layer, the canopy of the ulu eventually. Whereas a long-term, short-statured plant like coffee will enjoy the partial shade of being under the canopy of the ulu. So despite the fact that our tree rows are well-defined rows with pasture in between, when the larger specimens, especially like the ulu, reach their climax height and stature, you'll really lose the sense of any type of linear or row arrangement whatsoever. And that's partly designed, again, from the architecture of those long-term specimens. In addition, the pasture, the width of the pasture has been designed to allow for another central row of shade-loving, sort of less wind-tolerant plants, such as cacao, coffee, kava, to be planted in the center of these pasture rows. So this is an example of a diverse planting within the agroforestry design. We have some long-term specimens like this young Malaysian dwarf coconut. It's flanked on either side by some kava. This is the Hiva Ava, purple-stemmed Ava. So this is more of a 3 to 4 year crop. And then we have, growing in the understory, this is a galangal ginger. Of course, we have some taro. Rewinding about 6 months ago, there was a cabbage planting in here and some Asian greens as well. So again, another example of succession to where annual crops are integrated. And then as the shade and canopy closes in, we can plant more partial shade tolerant plants like taro. So here we are in a more mature agroforestry environment. So we have some good examples of a tropical polyculture here. We've got some sugar cane, peach palm. This is a Fairchild mango tree. Got some understory in here, such as tea leaf, and some younger palm, production palms coming on. We have some coconut. We have a dwarf Malay coconut. And again, the peach palm is some emergent specimens. And in the understory here, we have on the mango, we have vanilla growing. So this is the time of year when we pollinate our vanilla. So we'll be doing a little bit of that on the tour today. We're going to use a specialized piece of equipment for the pollination procedure. It's known as a toothpick. Here we have a good example of humans as a keystone species playing the role of a pollinator. The small bee that pollinates these vanilla orchids naturally is not present here in Hawaii, so it does require a little bit of human intervention. These flowers here were pollinated several days or a week ago, so these are the vanilla beans forming. So that'll happen to the flowers that we just pollinated. There's probably maybe 20 or 30 vanilla beans here, so that'll probably make a nice, maybe a quart of vanilla extract. So we have a few species of nitrogen-fixing trees. We have Halicoa, Leucocephalia, and Gloricidia. This is a curry leaf tree. Up into the taller register, we have Tangelo, some production palms in here, more Gloricidia. These are all relatively young and tender, and then just become an easy thing to create little mulch bundles with, high in nitrogen. So here we have a good example of a polyculture to where we have a vanilla vine on interconnected between citrus trees of different kinds. In the understory, we have kupu-kupu fern, tea leaf, katuk, some young nitrogen fixers, and some other understory shrub. This is a nice shot, actually, I just looked up. So it's a good example of an emergent coconut. We have a starfruit tree here. This is a Tahitian lime. And lots of understory here with the tea leaves, but then you can kind of see how a coconut can be in the emergent layer of the forest and still be productive. Initially, these trees were laid out in essentially rows with an offset planting pattern, which again, if you ascribe a circle or a sphere to each tree, what that ends up looking like on paper is a hexagonal lattice arrangement. So it's basically a geometrical way of basically packing in a spatial arrangement of packing the most specimens into any given area. Within that, we have interplants, and when these specimens grow into their mature form, you lose the sense of any type of row arrangement, and yet you still have less light competition, and you have also just with some space in between the major specimens, you have the ability to manage harvest and prune. We have a tangerine tree, an orange tree, there's a starfruit tree, so there's a triangulation on those. In the center of that triangle, we have this is a betel nut, actually, with some immature fruit on it there. And again, this is also connected with vanilla vine. This is an asper, Dendrocamus asper, which is a super strong construction grade bamboo. We've built some farm structures with it, including a farm stand. We have a Maine Coon natural farming piggery zone, which is kind of set within the agroforest, and kind of provides a home base. It has a couple of gates to allow the pigs out into the agroforest seasonally to harvest fallen fruit, manage some weeds in the understory, and also this becomes like a massive compost pile, essentially, that the nearby trees are certainly reaping benefit from. So the spray bottle here is a lactobacillus culture that we use, a lactic acid bacteria that we make from raw milk. And we utilize that in the pig, the piggery area as a way to manage the breakdown of manure and also the bedding itself. It's about a 4-foot deep excavation. So the pig is actually living on top of about 6 feet of essentially a compost pile that's made up of logs, branches, leaves, grasses. It's very comfortable for the animal, keeps the flies down. There's no real odor in here. And again, the lactobacillus keeps those things under wraps as well.
After recording this video, John and I sat down and had an in-depth conversation about tropical agroforestry in Hawaii and how collaborative cooperation can allow this model to be implemented on a large enough scale to compete with massive industrial farming. Please look out for the podcast. It will be linked in the description once it's published. If you enjoyed this video, please let me know in the comments. If you'd like to see more videos about agroecology, don't forget to like and subscribe. Thanks for watching!